is the rights of the accused. First and foremost is that the confessions in this country, in India, to a police officer are not admissible. So if you are an accused and you go and tell the police that you have committed a crime or you have committed a murder, if you are saying it only to the police, whether by itself can become a part of your conviction, no. They will have to investigate, they will have to find corroboration to your statement, and only in that case the police, the courts can rely on that confession that you have made, and if they find evidence, they can convict you. It's not that the confession made to the police can be recorded and can be used in a trial against you. So the basic line thing is that confessions made to a police officer are not admissible in court. Now, whether confession made to a person other than a police officer are admissible, it all depends on the circumstances the confession has been made, to whom it has been made. Now, suppose somebody goes, commits a murder and goes and tells his brother that, I have committed murder of so-and-so. Now, that if during the trial or during the investigation, the brother says that, yes, he had told me or he had confessed to me this thing, that part can become admissible. And that is what is called as extrajudicial confession, and that can be admissible. Whether confessions made to a magistrate or to a judicial officer are admissible, yes, they are admissible. So if a person goes to a court and then says, I have committed a murder, that becomes an admissible statement, and that statement can be recorded under section 164 of the CRPC, and that becomes an admissible, that then that can be basis of the conviction. So the basic rule is that confessions to a police officer are not admissible at all. Then in that case, why do police torture? Now, police torture for various reasons. One is that they want to find out how the crime has been committed. Secondly, what is admissible is that any other information which is leading to or becomes a part of the chain of the crime can become, or any that is a new discovery for the police, that is admissible. Suppose the person says that I have committed the crime and the gun has been kept in my house on a loft. Now, if the police go there with that person and that person takes out that gun from the loft, and the gun they can match with, or a knife they can match with the kind of injuries, then that removal of the gun or the knife and giving it to the police, that becomes an important chain in the evidence and in court. And hence, most of the torture happens because of that. Police wants to find the circumstances around this thing. They are not equipped to do a scientific analysis of the evidence or investigation, and hence the many times the torture happens. Now, in terms of rights of the accused, there are various guidelines which was given by the Supreme Court in the D.K. Basu case, which has now become part of the CRPC as part of Section 41. And some of them are like the person coming to arrest you should have a visible name tag with accurate and clear identification name tags. The particulars of such police persons who handle the interrogation also of the arrestee must be recorded in register. So while a person has been arrested and he is being interrogated, there has to be a police diary, and in the diary or in the case diary, and in the case diary it should be mentioned that so and so person is interrogating the person. It is not like just randomly any person can start walking into the police station and start interrogating the person. The person should have some jurisdiction to come to that police station and interrogate that person. The police officer carrying out the arrest shall prepare a memo of arrest at the time of arrest, and such memo shall be attested by at least one witness who may be either a member of the family or the arrestee or a respectable person of the locality where the arrest is made. It shall also be countersigned by the arrestee and shall contain the date and time of the arrest. So a person cannot be just whisked away from the house of them. If the person is being arrested, the person, an arrest memo or what we say is arrest panchanama has to be made, and it has to be signed by the somebody respectable from the locality if there is nobody at home. But if there is somebody at home, that person should sign. What the generally the police does is they don't do a panchanama at the time of the person taking away, and there are pros and cons to it. This, that the person is being detained initially, so you never know that person will be added to the crime, as we saw of open affairs, or is it just being taken for interrogation. Now, as I said, it is a pros and cons. It is completely double-edged sword. If you insist that the person should be taken away only after an arrest panchanama, then the person is certainly arrested and added to the crime. There are chances that the person may be interrogated. He is taken to the police station, he is interrogated, and he may not be arrested in the crime. He might be released. But as I said, it's a double-edged sword. Sometimes it's very difficult to say whether the person will be arrested or whether we should insist on a panchanama to be done. But in cases where we feel that the acrimony is so much between the complainant and the accused, or there is a chances of the person might be encountered in this thing, especially in the accused belongs to some gangs, then it is better to insist that the panchanama is done at the time of the arrest when the person is being taken away. Otherwise, if the person is being called for interrogation and just being taken for interrogation, we could wait for a few hours. And only if the person is being kept beyond evening or beyond night, then insist the police that the person, an arrest panchanama should be made. The reason behind arrest panchanama is also that the police don't do encounter and blame it on somebody else. Because how do you know that person has been taken away by the police? How do you know where the person has been taken away? So one of the reasons to all these provisions were brought in is to see that no torture happens or the person is encountered in a fake encounter, and see that the person is safeguarded, and hence these provisions have been brought in. The third and the most important, one of the important, is that a person who has been arrested or detained is being held in custody in a police station or interrogation or a center or the other law firm shall be entitled to have one friend or a relative or another person being informed about his welfare. That is basically that the person has been arrested and has been detained, and the particulars of where the person has been detained should be given to the relative of the person of welfare. Now, this is very not very common. The police do not very easily give out the place of the person where he is detained or how long he will be detained or to the relatives. Many times the lawyers have to call or intervene or go to the police station, and only then that the police will inform that the person has been arrested and kept in so-and-so lockup. Many times that even the lawyers are not informed about it, and then the only recourse remains is to file a habeas corpus petition in the High Court or the Supreme Court to check whether the person has been arrested, detained or encountered. Because how do you know that the person knows only, the relatives know only that the person has been taken away, but otherwise they don't have any other information. In that case, it becomes very important to meet the court as early as possible. So part of the third one is that the time and place and venue of the custody of the arrestee must be notified to the police, notified by the police when next to the next friend or relative of the arrestee. The person arrested must be made aware of his right to have someone informed of his arrest. Any entry must be made in the diary of the at the place of detention regarding the arrest of the person, which shall also disclose the name of the next friend. So where the person is taken also, that the person's name and this what time he was brought in should be recorded. Now this becomes very important where the police keep on changing the detention center. And that was how one of the things happened, that they name the it in Khwaja Yunus case, they were able to be nailed, because when they were taken to the Lonavala lockup, they had did mention that Khwaja Yunus was put in the Lonavala lockup, because initially the police refused to acknowledge that he was taken out of the police custody, taken out of Bombay. And then later they came up with this story that he was being taken to Aurangabad for investigation and he ran away from there. But later the documents revealed that he was taken to Lonavala, and his name was mentioned in the diary there as he was kept in the lockup there. The arrestee should where so request be also examined at the time of his arrest, and major and minor injuries, if any present in his body, must be recorded. So this is now the another aspect has been added to it. It says that every 48 hours while the person is in police custody, his medical examination has to be done, and if any fresh injuries are there, has to be mentioned, so that the court knows if there are any new torture that has taken place and in 48 hours, and if there are any fresh injuries. In case of women, the woman has to be examined by a women medical professional. Also, in case of arrest of women, there has to be a lady constable present, and in her presence only the person can be arrested. Copies of all documents, including the memo of arrest referred to above, should be sent to the Ilaka magistrate, that is the judicial magistrate. The arrestee may be permitted to meet his lawyer during the interrogation, but not throughout the interrogation. So once, but this also generally, we have to make an application to the court, and the court will specify the time when the lawyer can go and meet the accused. Otherwise, the police just refuse to allow the person to meet his lawyer even when he is in police custody. A police control room should be provided at all districts and state headquarters, where information regarding the arrest and the place of custody of the arrestee shall be communicated by the officer making the arrest. Now this becomes within 12 hours. Now this becomes very important, where sometimes the police deny that we have arrested a person. When you inform the major state control room or the district control room that you have arrested a person, then it becomes very difficult for them to deny that the person has been arrested. And hence, within 12 hours, of course, 12 hours is a very long period, but within 12 hours that the person, the state control room has to be, or the district and the district control room has to be informed about the arrested person's details and name and all other aspects. Now, in Bombay, how it is being misused is that moment, like somebody, one police station informs the control room that so-and-so has been arrested in one petty offense, like theft. And the other police stations have theft cases which are open or house-breaking cases. So they all start taking this person into police custody after that person's police custody is over from one police station and keep adding him, because they want to show that the crime has been solved. So actually the person may have committed only or may not have committed any of the crimes, but he'll be added, especially it happens in theft cases, to nearly 10 or 12 cases in which are in the neighboring jurisdiction. Like Matunga and Sion police station are literally next to each other. So we have seen several cases where Matunga informs the control room that so-and-so is arrested. That person is arrested by Sion also, or vis-a-vis. So though this was made for the protection of the accused, it has been very nicely misused by the police. The accused must be informed of his grounds of arrest. The accused must be told in connection with what offense the person he is being arrested, and whether the offense is bailable or non-bailable, that accused should be informed. And as I said, the police should inform the nearest relative of the accused also about all these other things.
Yeah. The medical examination that you said has to be conducted, that's by, that'll be a government medical officer, is it? Associated with the...
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Just one. Thanks.